Good evening, hockey fans. Thanks for joining us on this February Saturday night on CWHL Live, empowered by Hilberg and Burke. We are at Winsports Mark and McPhail Center, Arena A. We've got a premier matchup featuring Calgary and Montreal. My name is Sandra Persina. Thank you so much for joining us. And alongside me, like she's been here all season, Jenna Cunningham. Jenna, thanks for being here once again. And we've got the two best teams in the CWHL facing off in the final regular season series for both. So a special night for a number of reasons here in Calgary, both on and off the ice. We'll talk about that a little bit more throughout the broadcast. We have a number of special guests. First, though, Jenna, let's talk about tonight's game. We've got the best team, Calgary, versus the second place team in Montreal. Kind of almost fitting it's happening to close out the regular season, isn't it? It's hockey day in Canada. What are you thinking about tonight?
You know, this is going to be a really exciting matchup. I think it's been on the calendar for a really long time here in Calgary. As you can see, the rink is packed tonight. We've got tons of fans in the house. Big thing, Calgary's in purple tonight.
Mm-hmm.
Usually they're in red. So tonight's a special night. It's all about Start the Spark surrounding youth mental health. And during the starting warm-ups, you'll see they have young skaters with them tonight. It's that connection with the community again. So there's a lot of momentum around today, and I think it's going to be a really exciting game. We have some of the best players in the world that are going to go head-to-head tonight. And I can't wait to watch.
Yeah, and you mentioned that. Now, for Montreal, three of their players are in the top five for scoring in the league. You've got, of course, Marie-Philippe Pouin leading the way, followed by Anne-Sophie Batie and Caroline Ouellette. What will Calgary have to do to try and at least shut them down or keep them at bay?
Well, unfortunately, Caroline Ouellette's not in Calgary this weekend. That's going to be a big loss for Montreal. She has other commitments that has held her back from this trip. So we won't see her tonight. We won't get to see her break that record tonight, which is unfortunate. But the other two, between Poulin and Batie, they're going to be on fire. They always have good games. Poulin's leading the league in game-winning goals. No surprise, she has two golden goals with Canada.
She's pretty good.
So look for her. If it's a tight game, that's the player Calgary's going to want to stick it to. But Montreal's deep. Unlike the other teams in the league, when Calgary faces Montreal, they are deep from first line to fourth line. And Calgary's going to have to match that. We're going to see a lot of speed tonight. Two world-class goaltenders, one that's been in the program for a long time and has proven herself, one who's up and coming and perhaps the next face in Mashmeyer for Team Canada. So tonight's going to be an awesome game, and we're going to see fast, high-skilled hockey tonight, and it's going to be exciting.
So, interesting to note here, Calgary has yet to lose at home this season. Home ice has been a huge advantage for the Inferno. However, Calgary's lost three games this year, and two of them coming at the hands of Montreal. So something has to give a little bit on either side. What are you thinking there?
Yeah, I think tonight's a unique night. Calgary's played well at home and in front of a crowd. I think we're going to see the same thing. There's a little bit more passion tonight than there is in a regular season game that's not on a special event night. But this has been a good history between these two teams, starting with last year, Calgary-Montreal. It was a battle all through last season, obviously ending in the Clarkson Cup. So I think both teams are going to come out to play tonight. And home ice or not home ice, I think at the end of the day, these guys are just going to put on a good show.
Yeah, about 2,000 people here packed into Arena A at Winsport. We talked about it, Start the Spark. That's why you're seeing all this purple. That's why the Inferno are wearing purple tonight. That's what Jenna and I are wearing purple tonight. Purple, not usually a color we wear.
Not that often.
But we're wearing it tonight.
That is true.
And, of course, as we mentioned, the Inferno and their purple jerseys. And you'll be able to purchase those jerseys. They're actually auctioning them off. You can head over to calgaryinferno.ca/auction. They'll be on auction for a week, so you can get those players off their back jerseys. And last year, from what GM Jeff Stevenson was telling me a little earlier, $10,000 raised.
Isn't that amazing? And again, the whole idea behind this is, yes, if you're a fan and you would love a purple jersey, go and bid on it. But the big part of this is raising money for youth mental health. This money goes right back into the community, into working with students, and the mentorship program that's been developed through Start the Spark. So when you go to bid on these and you think about whether or not you want to, keep in mind that it is for kids, it is for the community, and it's for a really important cause. And without the support of those viewers tonight that are willing to bid on the jerseys, programs like these can exist.
Yeah, so that's calgaryinferno.ca/auction if you're interested in bidding on those. They will be released in increments, so they won't be all up for bidding at once, but they will be up for an entire week up until the playoff series next weekend, and we'll talk about the postseason a little bit later throughout the broadcast. Right now, though, we'll take you to center ice for our special opening ceremony.
Now please remain standing and remove your caps and hats as the choir from Holy Day Call and St. Matthew's School performs our national anthem, brought to you by Brookfield Residential.
That was their rendition of the Canadian national anthem. Of course, fitting we had our French verse in there.
Absolutely, and also fitting that we have an elementary school performing the national anthem tonight. Again, reminding those that are listening, this is all about youth mental health, promoting awareness and promoting the notion that it's okay not to be okay, and that there are role models in the community like the Calgary Inferno that are here to support and promote that notion that talking is the best solution. When you're not feeling supported, the best thing to do is find a buddy, talk to them about it, and let them know that you need somebody.
And great to see people like Sheldon Kennedy, of course, such a wonderful advocate for everything children and keeping them safe. He's such a great Calgarian Canadian, good human being. Rob Cote, a member of the Calgary Stampeders. He also signed a new contract today with the team, so I think it's a good day for him. Hopefully we'll have him on at one of the intermissions. We should have actually both of them chatting with us sometime today, so it'll be nice to touch base with a lot of the people that are involved with this amazing initiative. About 2,000 people packed here into Arena A at Winsport, so it should be a good night. Opening faceoff just moments away. Again, premier matchup here, Calgary, Montreal, first place versus second place. And we've got a double set this weekend, so that means we're playing tonight. We also have a second game tomorrow. I'm saying we, like I'm going to be on the ice, but we will have a second game tomorrow, 12:15 puck drop there. And we will have GM Jeff Stevenson with us a little bit later to work out what will happen with the playoffs, how many points Calgary needs to clinch that top spot, get that X by their name. They've already obviously clinched their spot in the playoffs, which will be played next weekend, a best of three series here in the Calgary area. Not all games will be played at Winsport, only the second game. We'll talk about that a little bit more and the reasoning for that happening, but puck drop just moments away.
You know, looking at the starting lineups today, you can see that Calgary's gone with a very responsible and defensive line starting. Lots of speed, lots of grit. On the other side with Montreal, you can see a lot of skill. They've got Bate out there, Poulin, Rougeau. They're going to try to set the pace. So this is going to be a good matchup to start our game off tonight and get this game going.
I have to say, just for myself as a fan of hockey, I haven't seen Poulin live since Sochi. So it's a bit of a treat for myself just to see her, because she is an exceptional, exceptional player. And puck drop, you'll notice that the Calgary Inferno wearing their purple jerseys. Yes, of course, they normally wear red, but these are their home jerseys for Start the Spark. Montreal in their road whites. And that's Cudmore with the puck for Calgary. Behind the Calgary net, Mickelson. Campbell down the right side. That's broken up. Davis fighting for it. Campbell back with the puck. She dumps it in, and that first line will go for a change. Montreal behind their net. That's Rougeau deciding what she'll do. She decides to flick the puck ahead. That stopped at the blue line. And a chance here for Montreal to regroup. Puck goes into the Calgary zone. Gosling for the Inferno. She's checked. Loose puck, flick behind the net. Calgary will look to clear things out. Chartrand for Montreal plays it back in. Bit of a broken pass there. Montreal pouncing on it. Chartrand centers. Nobody there. Broken up by Calgary. They'll go up ice. 2-on-1 opportunity. Backhand. Good save there by Labonte. She decides she'll hang on. So some good pace here to get this game going.
Yeah, definitely some good pace. I think Gosling on that last play, she'd want that back where she kind of sauced that puck up through the middle. You don't want to do that against Montreal. She got lucky that nothing came out of it and actually ended up going a 2-on-1 the other way. But the defense have to be consistent for Calgary. They can't be giving up those opportunities.
And shot from the point, makes its way through. It's in the crease. Labonte, good job there with her glove. Looks behind and just able to snatch it up. Things were loose there. So Calgary, perhaps that's what they'll be looking to do, looking for some rebounds, looking for some loose pucks, because you've got one of the most experienced goaltenders in the CWHL, in the world right now, still playing. She knows a thing or two about winning.
Absolutely. The key to beating Labonte is to get in front of her and cause traffic. You want to frustrate her, and Irwin, I think, can't believe she couldn't put that one home.
So a good chance here. They've traded a couple of good opportunities. 0-0 here early between Calgary and Montreal. Out in front, Mashmeyer. Again, a bit of a bobble by Calgary, and Montreal able to pounce it. Mashmeyer was in the right place at the right time to make a great save. Puck in front once again. Calgary having some trouble clearing things out. Bate to Poulin. Poulin behind the net. Still with the puck. From the point. Shot on goal. Mashmeyer directs it behind the net. back in behind the net. It's loose. Montreal still with the puck. Nice give and go there, but broken up by Calgary with an opportunity to get numbers ahead. Slap shot, wide left. And a good pace to get things going here. That's Amard. Doing a lot of work on her own here in the Calgary zone. Chance broken up by Calgary. Some speed going through the neutral zone. Nice save there by Labonte. She directs it into the corner. Still fighting for the puck in the corner. It trickles to the left side. That's Turnbull. Turnbull and Davis doing some work to the point. Slapper, good blocker. And Montreal with an opportunity to clear things out. Calgary, though, keeps it in. Great job there by Gosling. She drops it, shot on goal. Good save by Labonte. Labonte on her game thus far. Laquette, pass, looking for the redirect. That one goes wide. Warren with the puck now. Back to the point. Back to Laquette. Laquette shot. Nice save there by Labonte. And really good pressure there by Calgary. So Labonte decides she'll hang on, cool things down a little bit.
So you can tell already Calgary's game plan is obviously to hold the line. Their defense are being really aggressive. They want to make Montreal feel like they have to make a decision. You don't want to give them time and space. Calgary's been able to keep possession in the zone because of that.
So a crucial faceoff win here for Montreal, giving them some speed and an opportunity in the Calgary zone. Although that puck does trickle out. And Chartrand passing it off. And we'll have an icing call here.
You know, I'd like to go back to an earlier play. Mash made a really good save that ended up transitioning to where Calgary had some time in the offensive zone. And she didn't just make any save. She made a save on Bate, which is the second leading goal scorer on Montreal. So that was a really big save for her to get into the game and really zone in.
So let's talk a little bit about Bate and Sophie. I mean, you've played against her. So how do you face a player like that, somebody who's so potent offensively?
You know, she's underrated, I think, in a lot of ways. I think when you play on a team with this much star power, those players that do it all, whether it's grind it out, go to the net, you know, create offense, she sometimes can get lost in the crowd of their all-stars. And, you know, they did a film, I think, earlier this season that really promoted her and what she brings to the game. She's an incredible player and definitely a threat.
So, yeah, look out for her. Just about 5 minutes gone here in the opening period between Calgary and Montreal. 0-0 on the board. And we'll have another icing call here. So things getting a little disjointed, but they'll find their rhythm soon.
So far, a good pace. I think both teams would be happy with their transition game. They're trying to get that puck, move it quick, get up the ice. So far, so good.
So Irwin, good face-off win there. That one gets in through the point. Oh, what a save by Labonte. That was a beaut.
And you can see Mickelson looking up to the sky. I can't believe she didn't bury that one. That was an unbelievable save by Labonte. She's come to play today.
She has indeed. So she gets her legs wide. They're able to stay erect enough to grab that. So kudos to Labonte. I'd say that's a highlight read save, or highlight reel save if I saw one. So puck's in the corner right now, played off to that far side. And a chance here for Montreal to clear things out. Although Calgary pouncing, thought that might be offside. It's not. Shot, another great save by Labonte. We got a crash in the crease.
What a great opportunity there, hey?
Yeah.
You know, just a weird turnover. Irwin jumped on it. She faked the shot, trying to get Labonte to bite. And unfortunately, Johnson is on that. She's left-handed over there. If she was a righty, it'd be really easy to, you know, put that puck where you want it. She tried her best to get something on it, but just misfired. So, great break for Calgary. Unfortunately, they couldn't finish on that one.
Yeah, and I think that one was almost unexpected because I thought that might be called for offside that at the blue line. It was so quickly there. So Calgary really pouncing on any errant pucks that they can. That's something that you mentioned there, Jenna. So Johnston curls around. She puts it behind the net. That's tied up. Johnston once again. Johnston and Irwin. And Montreal looking to get this one out. They've got some speed coming down that right side. Centered. Trying to get it on her forehand. She can't. And Calgary will look to scoop it out. So things a little bit in the Calgary zone right now. And a chance here for Irwin. They'll dump it down. Labonte, she decides to leave that for 4 acres. Chance here for Deschene. And Mashmeyer decides she's seen enough. She'll hang on.
And I think we're going to see a lot of this tonight. A really tight game. There's not going to be a lot of breaks because both teams are so defensively sound and their forwards come back between the dots and they come back hard. You can see in those transitions, there's always somebody from each team in the area.
So 13:52 left here on the clock. 0-0. Another save there off the faceoff by Mashmeyer.
I think that was a set play there by Montreal. You could see they knew exactly what they were doing. Bate gets that puck, tries to put it up high. Great job by Mash to control that rebound and not allow for a rebound on that shot.
So another faceoff here in the Calgary zone. We'll get a swap here. That's Deschene for Montreal. Bate there. Poulin. Poulin with her speed. Puts it out in front. That one goes wide. Mikkelsen for Calgary. She was looking for Davis. That pass is intercepted. And we're on the half boards. That one goes to the point. Montreal can't keep it in, though. They're trying to regroup. Chance here. And Calgary will have to be fast because Montreal is forechecking very well. And again, errant pass in the Calgary zone. Back to the blue line for Montreal. That shot gets blocked. And a chance here for Calgary down that far side. She's by herself, swings into the middle, but loses control of the puck, takes a tumble, and Montreal with the counterattack right now, quickly into the Calgary zone. That's Ohl. She gets upended in the near corner. Puck is behind the Calgary net. They'll look for a breakout here. Warren was calling for that pass from Esposito, but she didn't see her. Calgary will just dump things in. Labonte decides to leave it. No, she'll play it. Saulnier for Calgary. Puck is on that near board. Warren dumps it in. Montreal plays it into their own corner. They'll work on breaking out here on your near side on your TV. And that'll be an icing call.
That was a great job by Calgary's fourth line. They're not going to see a ton of ice tonight, but they did exactly what they needed to do. They had possession of that puck. Esposito tried to create some offense off of it. Puck came back. They regrouped, got it deep, and they were able to go for a change. So that's exactly what coach of the Calgary Inferno is going to be looking for that fourth line today for Calgary.
So Montreal's Clément Hajdra dumping that into the Calgary zone. Calgary with an opportunity to counter right now. Some speed. Centers in front. Nobody there for the Inferno. So Montreal with a chance now. Great pace here in the first period. It's 0-0. 11:47 left on the clock. Calgary here. Shot. That one goes wide.
That was a nifty bit between the legs by Brianne Jenner there to pick that puck up.
So the captain, Deschene, gives it up. Now a chance for Calgary. That's Johnston with speed. Looking for the trailer. Center. Good give and go. Just goes wide though. And now Montreal. And that's Poulin. She decides to dump it in. And Calgary with an opportunity to get things going out of their own zone. Back to Montreal. Irwin. looking back for Irwin. She'll flick it in. Chartrand cleared that for Montreal. Montreal in the Calgary zone. Bit of a scramble on those boards. Back to the point. Slapper, redirection, bouncing. Bram for Calgary, able to corral it though. And that's Davis chasing it in for the Inferno. Montreal dumping it into the Calgary zone. Clement Hydra fighting for Montreal. She's got the puck right now, and we'll get our first penalty call of the night.
Yeah, it looks like a penalty is going to Montreal here on that one. Whether it might have been a hook, perhaps a slash on that one. We'll have to wait and see what the ref signals here. So far, this pace has been intense. It's been back and forth nonstop. You would think that this was a playoff game right now. They are battling hard for that first place position tonight. Both teams are really engaged in this game right off the bat.
So yeah, we've been talking about that all night. It's one versus two, and it's one versus two in special teams as well. Calgary with the second ranked power play in the CWHL. Montreal with the second ranked penalty kill. So we'll see if anything gives on this man advantage opportunity for the Inferno.
Absolutely. Calgary's power play sitting at a 20% success rate, which is pretty good. Montreal's penalty kill on the other side is equally up to task at 85%. So they have a fantastic penalty kill. Calgary's going to have to really move the puck and get pucks to the net to be successful on this one.
And that's what they're doing right now. Johnston with the puck on that near side. To Mickelson. Mickelson with a slapper. It's bouncing behind the net. Montreal trying to clear. They cannot. Mickelson tries to keep it in, but she can't. And an opportunity there just to dump it down for Montreal. So they'll kill a few seconds off the clock. A minute and 8 seconds left in the power play for Calgary here. 0-0 in the first period. 9:14 left on the clock. Turnbull for the Inferno. She'll curl around to the point. Back to Turnbull. She's on that half wall. Point, slapper, bouncing puck. Labonte, nice job just to corral it a little bit into the corner. So she gives her side an opportunity to relieve some of that pressure.
So as you can tell, Calgary's kind of setting up in that umbrella, moving a little bit into the overload. They're trying to post someone out in front. Twice it's been blocked. The D need to keep that puck low. If it's above the waist, it easily can be just knocked down, and that's what's happened to them twice now. So we'll see if the D adjusts to that and start shooting that puck a little bit lower for a tip or even a rebound.
So Calgary just trying to get organized here out of their own zone and work their way. 10 seconds left here on the power play. A really aggressive forecheck by Montreal. Esposito now for Calgary. Behind the net. Shot that goes high and wide. Calgary still able to keep it in. And Montreal with their first kill of the night.
That was a great job by Montreal. It all started with Batea and that forecheck right off the bat when Calgary first went on the power play. She was able to get it deep, gain a little momentum for her teammates on the penalty kill.
So an opportunity there for Calgary off the point, but another good save by Labonte. She has looked fantastic tonight. She's made 5 saves, but many of them of the excellent kind, as we'd like to say. There we go, Campbell, speed. And that goes off the shoulder of Labonte.
That was just a great positional save by Labonte. She didn't really see the puck, but she was in the right position to make that save. She was out at the top of her crease, big shoulders, chest nice and big, was able to deflect that.
Calgary now going into the Montreal zone. That's dispatched by Montreal. Chance here for Deschene, but she loses the puck. And now Calgary back with it. On that right side. Chance here, digging near that crease. It's out in front. Montreal able to clear things out. A bit of a miscommunication there by Calgary, but good job by Mickelson to react really well and just pounce on that errant pass.
Yeah, she had to get back quick. She jumped in on that play, and it kind of bounced out to the blue line, and she was forced to back check. She's been on a bit of a scoring tear for a defenseman the last couple weekends, and you can see her eagerness to be offensive. In that case, she had to make sure she really got back to the D zone.
And let's talk a little bit about this forecheck from Montreal, because of all the games you and I have called this season, I've never seen a team forecheck and pressure Calgary like they have thus far.
That's what makes Montreal so good. They're so consistent. They're so dedicated to their systems, and they play them so well. That's why they're successful. That's why they're one of the best teams in the league. It's going to be the hardest thing for Calgary to break up. Their D and wingers are going to have to be on the same page tonight to be able to make nice, smooth, quick transitions.
So 5:52 left here in the opening frame between Calgary and Montreal. It is 0-0. Very entertaining hockey game here at Winsport Arena A in Calgary. About 2,000 people here as part of Start the Spark. Centered pass, Mashmeyer decides she'll hang on. Probably Montreal's best chance of the evening thus far, but incredible pace.
I mean, it's hard to argue on that one. You can see why Poulin's such a threat. Out of nowhere, she can turn into that next gear and just blow by the D. She created offense there really from nothing. The Inferno D were in a good position, but she was able to get that puck out in front, and a good opportunity there for Montreal.
So Montreal's top line out right now. Calgary, though, they win the draw in their defensive zone and an opportunity here. Jess Campbell, she's got some speed down that right side. She'll dump it in. But it's Montreal trying to clear things out. Calgary was able to keep it in momentarily. That's Mickelson actually in a little bit deeper than what she usually is. And a chance here now for Deschene. One-on-one, she'll drag behind the net. She's looking for help, nobody there. She's calling for it, still with the puck. Dumps it into the corner. Montreal looking for an outlet pass. Nobody's there, back to the point. That's 4 acres. To Ohl.
A little bit of a unique fact about 4 acres. She's actually from Alberta, so her whole family's here tonight watching the game, and it's a good opportunity for her to come home and play in front of her family, and kind of unique to play against the Alberta team.
Yeah, as an Alberta kid, I think it'd be a little weird playing versus a Calgary team or even an Edmonton team. I'm not sure who she supports. Chance there for Calgary. That one goes high and wide by Esposito. They're scrambling and fighting for it on that far side.
Another great move there by Esposito, creating some offense.
Shot on goal. Great save by Labonte. Really like how she came out of her crease to challenge this shooter. She looks big, and the puck goes right into her chest.
I mean, it just shows that skill level of Labonte, able to cover the space in her crease, be nice and big, like you said, but not just cover, be able to not allow a rebound. Those rebounds are what kill you. They're the what ends up in the back of the net, and a test of a good goaltender is their ability to control their rebounds.
So chance here for Montreal, center. That one deflected by Calgary, so good defensive job, and the Inferno with three players going ahead. Montreal, though, with an opportunity here to clear things out. We'll get through the neutral zone. And back to Calgary. Dumped into the corner. Cudmore trying to chase that down, but it's Montreal. Chartrand with the puck. She'll dump it into the Calgary zone. Mashmeyer controls it for her blue liner. That's the captain, Jenner. She'll send it to the left side. Johnston drags. That one goes wide. Johnston once again sends it behind the net, and Montreal looking to clear things out. Montreal, that's Rougeau down the left side. Some speed there by Poulin. She gets to the puck. It's tied up. Bate decides to join her. So 2-on-2 there, deep in the Calgary zone. Refs telling them to get cracking with that puck and move it out. 2:37 left here. in the first period. 0-0 between Calgary and Montreal. Great shot from the point. Mashmeyer deflects it to the other side. She got a good view of that puck despite all that traffic in front of her. Played behind the net to Bette. Back to the point. Centering pass. It's loose. Montreal still with possession. Great shift here by Montreal. Shot on goal. That one hits a shin pad. And Calgary will just look to dump that puck into the Montreal zone and calm things down a little bit.
Great pressure by Montreal. They did a good job of puck possessing on that, waiting for the open shot and trying to create something out of it.
So Calgary getting that puck that was bounced off a skate. Shot, that one doesn't get through. It's out in front. A lot of sticks, still bouncing. Chance for Campbell. Campbell shoots high and wide.
What a great block by Montreal on that one. Campbell had a good opportunity to put that one in the back of the net, and just a great block shot by Montreal.
Turnbull for Calgary. So the team's trading some good pressure here late in the first period. About a minute 15 left to go. 0-0 on the board. In the neutral zone here. Montreal. Laquette for Calgary. And that's offside.
Great pressure by both teams. I think going into the first intermission, they're going to be pretty happy with the pace. This is what this game's going to be all about. It's going to be back and forth. Each team's going to have their opportunity to puck possess, to create offense. They're also going to have the opportunity to play strong defense and figure out how to shut down the other team. And so far, they've proven that tonight, and that's exactly how this game's gone.
So faceoff win here for Calgary. Less than a minute left to go. Chartrand for Montreal, able to clear that one out. Chance here, some speed, that's Poulin. Hachin centers, Bette, Poulin. She loses that puck. So chance for Calgary to get things out. Labonte deflects that into the corner. 20 seconds left on the clock. Hachin, that pass is intercepted. Johnston was fighting for that, but Bette is able to get it in. And a bit of a loose puck there, so three members of the Calgary Inferno weren't sure. A little bit of hot potato there. Luckily, yeah. No real damage done. Mashmeyer was ready for the opportunity.
There was definitely a little bit of confusion there, and actually Mash kind of looked like she was also unsure of where that fluttering puck was going. So good job on her part to really squeeze those pads and not let it trickle through.
So 5 seconds left here on the clock. So first period now in the books. Calgary and Montreal play to a 0-0 score. And as you had mentioned just not too long ago here, I think both teams are going to be pretty pleased with what transpired.
Yeah, I think both teams are going to be happy with their first period. Both of them were pushing the pace. They each had equal opportunities, both offensively, defensively. Montreal did a great job killing that power play. But at the same time, Calgary did a good job of setting up. They were able to get into that umbrella, move over into the overload, get a couple shots. They're going to go back into the dressing room and think to themselves, what can they do to make sure that that puck gets through to the net on the power play? But overall, I think it was a really good first period. Both teams played well. I think Labonte looks like she's zoned in tonight. Everything she's doing, all of her moves are intentional. She's being big. She's coming to the top of her crease. Even the smallest of rebounds, she's making sure she's directing them. So she's going to be the biggest thing for the Calgary Inferno to solve tonight because she's on her game. On the other side, I don't think Mashmeyer's been tested that much. She's had a couple good saves, but a lot of times they've been coming off broken plays. So like that last one, there's a miscommunication, kind of a floppy puck. She was able to make the save, which is important too. So it's just a great game, and it's going to continue to be that way.
And what did you think of Poulin and Bette in that first period? A lot of speed.
A lot of speed, and I think we are seeing exactly what we expected. Both of them are creating offense, but they're doing a great job defensively. Bette was a big part of that penalty kill. So they both come to play today too.
All right, we're going to actually head down to the dressing room right now, and Kenzie, take it away.
I'm here with Jessica Campbell for the Calgary Inferno. Jess, the game you've been organizing forever is finally here. Tell me what this game means to you.
I mean, obviously, it's more than a hockey game. Just looking at the turnout, seeing all the kids in the stands, that's what it's about. Obviously, mental health is near and dear to my heart, and faced my own challenges with it in my life. And so I think, you know, just seeing this many kids come out and celebrate it, that's what it's all about, and I'm just really thrilled.
And probably arguably one of the biggest crowd you guys have had ever at Winsport. How has that affected the game so far?
Yeah, I think we knew we'd come into a tight game and a competitive game, so obviously having a huge crowd behind us is advantage us, but I think we just got to stick to our game plan and give them something to cheer about.
Yeah, and right off the bat, both teams were high speed, high tempo, energy and everything. No score yet. What does your team have to do in the next 40 minutes to get up? Get on the scoreboard, essentially.
Yeah, I think just put lots of pucks on net. Like I said, stick to our game plan, play with speed, that tenacity, win the puck races, the battles, come out with the puck, because I think, you know, it goes both ways. We get momentum, then they get momentum, and it's just back and forth. So I think if we can keep it shift after shift, then we know we're going to get one on the board here soon.
Okay, thanks, Jess. Good luck in the second.
Thank you.
When I was 7, I wore these gloves. They held this stick. Well, these skates carried me over the blue line.
We won the championship. And now, it's all yours.
Cool.
Oh.
And this mouth guard.
I'll get my own. Thanks.
The fifth season is when spirit for the game gets passed down. That's why we're proud to support over 5,000 teams.
Not every group of girls has a friend in martial arts. Not every group of girls wants one. Not every girl spars with guys twice her size and age. Her friends say she has no life, but she does. Not every girl has a life as cool as mine.
I am pleased to be joined by Sheldon Kennedy, a great Calgarian, great person. We're so honored to have you here, and this is a special night. You're donning your purple jersey for Start the Spark. Why don't you tell us a little bit about how this initiative came to be and why it means so much to you?
Well, I mean, really, I guess I get inspired because we see the Inferno players, as spearheaded with Jessica and her teammates, going into schools, mentoring young kids. And I mean, to me, that's what we need. And I don't think they get enough credit for how important that is, and especially young people's lives. I mean, we have 6 busloads of kids from Holy Cross School that have, most of them have never seen a hockey game before in their life. And they're here to watch, you know, their mentors. And I think for me, seeing people giving back and giving to our young people, knowing the importance of that gets me inspired. And, you know, really, I haven't done a lot for this game. It's been the Inferno and the Inferno players, and, you know, they're the ones that need the credit.
And clearly a great relationship between yourself and Jessica Campbell. How did that all come to be?
Soupy, as I call her.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, Jessica, believe it or not, Jessica's mom from St. Lazare, Manitoba, I used to referee her mom playing hockey.
Wow.
As a young kid. I'd be 12. Me and my brother used to referee their women's hockey team, and that was a long time ago. So, I ended up meeting Jessica just from, you know, back home, and then, you know, I mean, she's more than qualified to be running and being the director of communications at the Sheldon Kennedy Child Advocacy Center, but she brings so much to the table. I mean, she's, you know, she's smart, she's enthusiastic, she's passionate, and she can relate, and I think that is critical.
And this is the second year for this event, Start the Spark. How have you seen it grow in the last year?
Well, I mean, it's really growing, I think. Like if we look at Holy Cross and we look at the way they've embraced it at an administration level within that school and the way that the kids have embraced that mentorship program, these are things that I think need to keep going, and they just keep growing. And if we look at what's going on here today, I mean, this rink is filled, you know, I don't know, there's probably 2,000, 1,500 to 2,000 people here. And to me, that's incredible to get that many people committed to get in their vehicle, to get out, to watch a great hockey game. I mean, this is an awesome hockey game. But you know what? They can relate to the players. And that's the key. These kids see them, and that the Inferno players show up in their classrooms. They allow them. They make them feel safe. They have lots of conversations, I'm sure, about difficult issues. And now they can see them, what they do. And to me, this inspires so many, when maybe sometimes they don't believe they can do anything. And that's what I think today is all about. I mean, it inspires so many people to think that, you know what, the sky's the limit.
And I've noticed a lot of kids, they recognize you and they want to talk to you. How does that make you feel?
Well, you know what? I haven't played hockey in a long time.
Well, but you look pretty good out there when you were shooting.
Well, I better let Rob win.
Right? Oh, okay, yeah.
You know, we've had over 5,000 kids come through the Child Advocacy Center, and that's a lot of kids in our city. And you know, I think it's important to put your hand out and say hi. And to me, you need to be approachable. I think lots of times when you look at mental health, you look at the issues we deal with, child abuse, I mean, lots of times it's invisible to people, and lots of times these things happen because of ignorance and indifference. And in my opinion, you need to put your hand out, you need to say hi to kids, you need to, you know, make sure that you're the one that's approaching them and saying, hey, you know, how you doing? Are you having fun? You know, and I think by doing that, it inspires kids to, I don't know why they know me. I'm an old hockey player. But you know what? We do a lot in this community. We're in the schools, and you know, I do it because it's important.
Yeah.
It's not about, you don't get do this to be famous at all. I do this because I know what would have been important in my life, and I know how important it is, and it's the number one thing that kids tell me when they're going through this, is that, you know, they don't feel safe. And, you know, a lot of times we just need somebody to be there for them. And that's what we can do.
Well, I think on behalf of myself and everybody here and all Calgarians, thank you so much for doing what you do. It's incredible to have that voice out there. We're so proud that you're in Calgary, because you've done so much, not only for our community, but for the entire country. So thanks for joining us tonight, and please continue doing what you do. It's such a pleasure to have you here.
Oh, thanks, Andrew. It's my pleasure to be a part of it.
And enjoy the rest of the game. Should
I know,
be a good
it's
one.
It's an awesome game. Right
thanks,
on.
Sheldon. Take care.
Thank you.
And with me now, we have Rob Cote from the Calgary Stampeders. Rob, thank you so much for joining us tonight. And you are part of this initiative, Start the Spark. How did you get involved?
I've known Sheldon through a couple of charity events that we've done in the past, and obviously familiar with his story and the work that he's done, incredible work across the country, but focused specifically in Calgary. They do a great thing with the Advocacy Center, so he kind of got me involved, and I've been in touch with Jessica Campbell, who's fun to watch her flying around out there tonight.
That she is, yes.
Yeah, so trying to help support the great work that they're doing.
So how about you as an athlete? I mean, what does it mean to be able to be involved in something like this, where you do have a voice in the community? You are an Alberta kid, you're a Calgary kid, and you're able to have this platform.
It means a lot to me. It's something that I didn't realize maybe getting into pro football, that it would give you that platform. And it's kind of, some people think it's a responsibility to give back. I think it's a privilege. It's something that not everybody, if I take this jersey off, then nobody really cares what I have to say. But because of what I get to do on the weekends in the summer, I get to come out and support great causes like this, and you know, raise some awareness and start conversations that maybe wouldn't have started otherwise.
So you know your sport of football pretty well, but what are you seeing here tonight? We've got so many Olympians here. We were just saying off air, how many gold medalists are playing on this ice right now between Calgary and Montreal. What do you think of the product?
It's amazing, and that's what, yeah, we were talking before. This is the speed of the game that they're playing here is very real, very
yes.
good. You've got some world class hockey players here, and I think it's a good. It's unfortunately a great kept secret in Calgary.
Yes.
We need to stop it being a secret, because you come down and you see the kids all in the stands. Everybody's having a great time, and you watch some unbelievable hockey.
Well, the second period just about to get underway. We'll wrap up here with Rob Cote. By the way, he signed a new contract. He's sticking around with the Calgary Stampeders. So hopefully we will see you at some more Inferno games in the future.
I hope so, too. Thanks for having
Thanks,
me.
Thanks, Rob, so much. Second period just about to get underway here between Calgary and Montreal, 0-0. We had an excellent first period. I'm sure we will have an excellent second period. Jenna, what are your thoughts here for the middle frame?
I think we're going to see a lot of the same pushing the pace. I think goals are going to come off of just pucks being put to the net and players crashing the net. It's going to be hard to create a lot of space on both sides, as both defenses on each team are so strong.
And we were talking here in the intermission between Sheldon Kennedy and Rob Cote, both who are professional athletes, and they mentioned this speed is something that they say is just incredible, because I think you take for advantage of how great this game really is, and something Rob just mentioned, a secret, and that's what it is. That's what this league is, and to have like 2,000 people here packed into this arena, just a testament to people seeing it and being able to embrace it.
Well, I think it just goes to show the growth of the game here in Calgary. From my first season to now, I would have never thought 6 years later, here we are with 2,000 fans. And it takes people like Sheldon Kennedy and Rob Cote, who are prominent sports people in the community, to come out to our games and raise awareness, because that's what we need. We need those connections in the CWHL so that people will come out and recognize how great this game is.
So here we are early in the second period, 0-0 on the board. So we'll have a face-off here in the Calgary zone.
Yeah, it looks like there's actually going to be a penalty to Bridget Laquette on that one. Judging by the sound of the boards, it sounds like it was a pretty good hit. They called her on interference. Montreal, one of the top power play units in the league, is going to get a chance to go to work here. We're going to see how Calgary does killing it.
And just a note to our watchers, unfortunately, the angle that we have here, we couldn't see that penalty, so our apologies for not calling it. Calgary here with a chance to counter on the PK. Nice drag there by Mickelson, of all people. She's getting in, like we were saying, on the scoring the past few games. Counter. Chance here for Montreal, and good job there by Mashmeyer. She came to the top of her crease and was able to pounce on that puck.
You can see the confidence that Mickelson's gained since those last couple of games where she scored goals. You know, great move by her. She creates an offensive opportunity. It did give up a 2-on-1, 3-on-1 the other way, so those are things that you kind of have to gauge and see whether or not they're worth it. Mash was up to the task on that one.
So Poulin, she gets waved out. Day will come in and take it for Montreal.
They're just reminding those wingers to stay outside the dot, outside the circle. Some refs are a little bit more strict about it than others. So Mash just covers that one up, and we're gonna reset. Faceoffs are such an important part of the game. They dictate puck possession, and puck possession, as we know, relates directly to scoring opportunities. So big defensive win there by Calgary. It's in a really important part of the game that's sometimes not talked enough about.
So Montreal here on the power play. but Calgary with the puck, and a good job to try and clear it there. Takes a bit of a hop. And it looks like we will have a delay of game call.
We're going to have the officials talk about this one and just see if it was touched. This could be a huge momentum swing here for Montreal if they get a 5-on-3.
Yeah, that Montreal bench pretty adamant that it went out without any sort of deflection or anything off the glass. So they're going to chat here. And I don't see that too often where a coach opens the gate
to talk about it.
Yeah.
And you
She's
know what?
Calling for the refs.
It
so.
Looks like the refs figured that it went out. If it goes out over top of the bench, it's not a delay of game. That one was really close. But if it goes out over the corner of that glass, where the bench doesn't start, it is a delay of game. It's considered to be in zone. So I think that's what they're talking about now, is they're talking a little bit about where that puck went out. It's hard in an arena like this one.
So it looks like no delay of game call. So there was an opportunity for a 5-on-3. However, it will not come to fruition. And we'll just go to the 5-on-4. A minute and some change here left on the power play for Montreal. Vite on the half board to the corner. Poulin to that corner. Puck takes a bit of a hop on the half board. And Calgary will push it out of the zone. However, Poulin curls around. She comes in with some speed. And Mashmeyer will cover up there. Interesting what Poulin was trying to do is drive through those two blue liners and maybe look for a little bit of a screen.
Well, I mean, that's what makes her one of the best players in the world, her deceptiveness. So not only with her skating ability, but what she can do with the puck and with her hands. It looked like she didn't have a lot of space. It took her half a second, half a stride to be able to create something and get a shot off. She's dangerous no matter where she is on the ice.
So Clément Hadro with the win on that faceoff. Montreal still with 35 seconds left here on the power play, their first of the night. They'll cycle on that near side. To the corner, behind the net. Mickelson tries to push her off. So bit of a stick check.
Great battle there by Mickelson, just relentless, not willing to give any space.
And kudos there as well to Johnston, who was able to do a good job and basically kill the remaining seconds off that man advantage for Montreal.
No surprise there. Calgary had three Olympians on that penalty kill, each with, you know, at least a total of four or five even gold medals. So lots of experience.
Yeah, we were saying, and I've probably repeated myself a bunch of times, but a lot of gold medalists here tonight. 2-on-1 here for Calgary. Centers Campbell. Good save by Labonte. She drives it into the corner.
That was really the first time Labonte's been challenged this period, and once again, great job redirecting that rebound far out into the corner.
So Campbell there on the forecheck, tries to center it. Calgary to the point for Gosling. Gosling plays it back in. Half board, Gosling calling for it on the blue line. She's curling in, ready to pinch a little bit.
This is Calgary's workhorse line. They are all over the place. They're in the corners battling. Definitely a fun line to watch for Calgary.
Gosling left it for Turnbull. Turnbull gets upended there, so she loses the puck. And Montreal looking to clear it, but they can't. Calgary's getting a line change, so they don't have their full lineup out right now. Irwin and Bram in for it right now. Good battle here, Irwin. Tries to center it. Back to Irwin. Krom's calling for it from the point, but they decide to play it into the corner. Johnston comes in on the backhand. It's bouncing. And it looks like Labonte's actually lost her stick, so one of the blue liners gave her theirs. Chance here. And bit of an awkward because she didn't have her stick, so she's trying to do her best. Without that big paddle,
That was just a fantastic shift. Actually, a couple shifts. Calgary got that puck in deep. They were able to get a change, and that all came off of that penalty kill. Like you said, Labonte was missing her stick, and Bailey Bram was aware enough to realize that, and she tried to jam that puck in down low. She didn't try to go up high. She knew that her best opportunity to score on that one was going to be along the ice, but Labonte once again was up to the challenge and was able to keep that puck out.
And there we go, talking about that experience with Labonte. She's faced everything from professional hockey to so many international games, so she adapts to basically any sort of situation. Calgary with a face-off win. Nice play there. Calgary in the corner. Montreal with a chance to clear, but Calgary standing up at that blue line, and the puck trickles out just a little bit. They'll dump it back in, and Labonte decides that she'll leave it. Duchene. And now Poulin with speed comes out in front. That puck gets deflected barely, but Mashmeyer was tracking it well with her glove. Jenner to Saulnier for Calgary. Center, nobody there. Chance for a slapper. Mickelson. And Labonte saw that and snatched it in.
This pace just keeps getting better. Each team's transitions are just so quick, and that's why these are the two top teams in the league. Their ability to take the puck and create something out of nothing. All of a sudden, they're in their zone. Three or four strides later, there's an offensive opportunity for them. We really saw that on that play. Montreal went in, Poulin had an opportunity. Calgary comes back half a second later and creates their own opportunity.
So 14:39 here left on the clock. We're in the middle frame. It is 0-0 between Calgary and Montreal. Clement Hydra loses that puck, but back to Montreal possession. We're in the corner. Give and go. And Calgary with a chance to clear it. They can't. Montreal scooped it in just for a moment, but Cudmore for Calgary. And some speed down that far side, centers. It gets deflected. That's Mickelson in deep for the Inferno. She's fighting for the puck on that half board into the corner.
Mickelson needs to be a little bit aware on this. Calgary does have technically their fourth line, if you can call it out. So she needs to make sure that she's not getting too deep and leaving one of her forwards on the blue line.
And Mickelson, of course, known for her offensive abilities. One of the highest scoring defensive players in the league right now. Almost called there for too many men. But Montreal was able to get their bodies across the board, so no harm done. They'll dump it in. Mashmeyer leaves it. Some pressure there, though, by Montreal, so they have to move it quickly. Mashmeyer to Pierre. Pierre loses the puck. However, that is picked up by Turnbull. She's got speed coming down the center. Great save there by Labonte. She deflects it into the corner for Montreal. She's made 13 saves tonight. Turnbull. Centered out in front. Montreal with a chance to clear, and they do. And now Jess Campbell with the puck for Calgary. She gets that outlet pass down the left side. Davis, bit of a bouncing puck. And Montreal will have a chance to clear things out. A deflection there off a skate. Johnston with speed for Calgary. She'll chase that behind the net, centers, and they score! Haley Irwin! Wow. 1-0 Calgary.
That was a great goal, short side. It was a little bit of a delayed reaction from everyone because there wasn't a lot of room there. Rebecca Johnson, Haley Irwin, their chemistry goes back a long time. They've played in the Olympics together. They've played through centralization years together. They just have a natural chemistry. Irwin was able to pop that one in, short side. Rebecca Johnson does a great job kind of pulling that defense in, making them think that she's going around the net and giving Irwin the opportunity to have an offensive opportunity. That was just an overall great goal.
A lot of hard work there by Johnston to get that puck in. She curled around and delayed reaction because it actually looked like it went off the side of the net because, as you had mentioned, there was just such little space there on that near side. But yeah, snuck by Labonte. So Calgary with a 1-0 lead. here in the second period. 12 minutes and 8 seconds left on the clock. So we'll see if Montreal will reply. Boulin, that shot doesn't miss by much. It was bouncing on that far side. Mikkelsen scoops it over. Bounce pass to Johnston. Johnston takes the body, but does a great job to get that puck in. Bram will try and chase it down for Calgary. Plays it into the corner. Nice outlet pass there for Bate, but she loses the puck. She was looking for Rougeau, and now Mikkelsen has it for Calgary. That puck is dumped in. Montreal with possession. And now a chance for Calgary. Standing up at that blue line, she curls around on the half board, looking for some help. Montreal here. Chance, backhand, Mashmeyer takes that one up high, bouncing a little bit, but she does a good job to control it and leave it a 1-0 game with 11:06 to go.
Absolutely, great job there by Mashmeyer. Once again, I think I just want to draw back to our attention to why Calgary's in purple tonight. We want to really put home that this is all about Start the Spark, and it's an organization, I'm sure you talked with Sheldon Kennedy, that Jess Campbell has started an initiative where Calgary Inferno players are actually going into schools in Calgary to be mentors. And that's what all these kids are doing here tonight. They've been impacted by Start the Spark in some way, and it's just incredible to see.
So chance there for Calgary. We'll talk about that a little bit more in a second here, Jenna. That puck is dumped into the corner, now behind the net. Saulnier dumps that in. Bouncing puck, and that one is deflected out. But you will notice, as you were saying, the Inferno in their purple jerseys, and you can actually purchase those online. They're part of an auction. It's calgaryinferno.ca/auction. And last year, over $10,000 was actually raised by these jerseys. I had heard that Rebecca Johnston's went for over $1,000. Of course, an Olympian, gold medalist, so that's quite valuable. And of course, it comes back to giving back to the community. So a great initiative here by Jessica Campbell, as well as Sheldon Kennedy. We heard from Rob Cote, one of the football players here for the Stampeders. So if you want more information, calgaryinferno.ca. And now Calgary with a power play opportunity. And we'll see if they can make it a 2-goal lead here in the second period. 10:15 left on the clock. Centering, bouncing around. Centers, slapper, actually a fake shot. That one's played back to the point, to Turnbull. Irwin fans, she's got another chance. Nice pad save there by Labonte. Davis for Calgary, it's bouncing just slightly. Bram's able to keep it in. Irwin, shielding that puck with her body. On those half boards, Bram for Calgary. Puck underneath some bodies there. Back to the point. That's Mikkelsen. She slaps it in. The puck is bouncing. It's blocked, and Montreal is able to clear it down the ice.
Once again, great job by Montreal. They're a little chaotic. They weren't set up in their PK because of a bouncing puck, but they do such a good job of just getting their bodies in front of pucks. When you're in desperation mode, you just got to get in front, block it, do what you can to keep the puck out of the net.
Centered, chance here for Johnston. She's not able to get a stick on the puck. And a 2-on-1 opportunity here for Montreal on the PK. Centers off the post. We could hear that one all the way up here. I'm sure you heard it on your broadcast. And now Calgary looking to counter. Chance here on the power play. The puck bounces into the corner for Jenner. They fight for it. It's tied up in some skates. 13 seconds left here on the power play for Calgary. They're trying to get it back to the point. Cudmore's calling for it. Nearly went out. It didn't. It's bouncing. And, oh, it looks like they will call it out. So it did trickle out. It's tough to see from our vantage point here.
It was a bit of a delayed call on that one. That one's a little bit hard to call after the shot's been in the been taken and the rebound's there. But good break for Montreal. They'll have a chance to get a change here, and there's only 3 seconds left here on the power play, so.
And the goalie's best friend for Mashmeyer, a great opportunity there for Montreal to tie this game up. They're going 2-on-1 on the PK. and that post bailing Calgary out. So Irwin scoring for Calgary earlier in the period to make it a 1-0 game. 8:20 left here on the clock. And it looks like Calgary will head back to the man advantage.
Yeah, it looks like there's going to be a cross-checking penalty here. I don't think Montreal is very happy about this call. And actually a little bit surprised by who it's going to. I think it might be Hill going to the box. Yeah, Carly Hill's going to the box there for a cross check. So Calgary has another opportunity here to expand their lead. They really need to take advantage of this. Montreal's done a good job penalty killing, which is of no surprise considering on the year they are killing of penalties at 85%, which is pretty incredible.
And Poulin with a crucial win on that faceoff. Pretty incredible. She does it all. She plays on the PK, yeah. She plays on the PP, and she can put a puck in or two during 5-on-5. So an exceptional player who leads by example, not only because she has the C on her jersey. So Calgary drives that puck into the corner. Bouncing. Bounces out of the zone. And again here, an opportunity for Montreal on the PK. Chance for Bate. Great save by Mashmeyer. She got her blocker on it. And a chance now for Calgary to come down the ice on the power play. Irwin scoops it in center. No one was available for that pass, though, and an easy opportunity for Montreal to clear it down the ice. Calgary will regroup here. Mikkelsen surveys the field. Calgary working their way. Loses the puck, and a chance here for Montreal again. Nice stick there by Johnston, preventing any sort of damage. And Montreal, an exceptional job on this penalty kill. 40 seconds left on Calgary's man advantage. Cudmore on that far side. She stops. Drops it off. Johnston back to the point. Slapper from Cudmore. Chance here, great save by Labonte. She was able to get to that near side, cover it off well in her butterfly style, and make it, and leave it rather, a 1-0 game.
You know, it's no surprise that Montreal's creating 2-on-1s on the shorthanded. If you look at the top 5 players in the CWHL with shorthanded goals, Montreal has 3 players in that top 5. So they really like to create offense off of the PK, and that's something Calgary needs to be aware of.
Yeah, they're looking to pounce on any sort of errant pass or bobbled puck. So Calgary will need to be very, very key at their blue line. Chance here, bouncing puck in front. Montreal able to corral that. And here another chance. They've got some speed down that far side. Hill's going to join as she was coming out of the penalty box. Unfortunately, the pass didn't get to her, and she's taken down in the Calgary zone.
Another great kill there by Montreal.
Yeah, they've had a couple of those. Calgary's goal coming as an even strength marker. Chance here. Nice job by Campbell to swing out in front. And now Montreal. And it looks like Calgary is now headed to the penalty box. So Montreal will take their first ranked power play and try to tie this game up.
Yeah, this is going to be a great opportunity for them. They had 2 really great penalty kills there, created some offense off of them. Now they're going to really look to capitalize. Esposito is going to go to the box here for tripping. It's one of those unfortunate ones. Her stick, it's not even that she hooked. The other player actually got tangled up in her stick. So that's an unfortunate one for Esposito. But let's see what Montreal does here. They need to start creating more quality opportunities, getting in front of Mashmeyer, making sure that someone is up in her face and making her really have to make that save.
Yeah, Mashmeyer's looked very good tonight. She's seeing the puck very well. Nothing's beat her so far. 5:25 here left in the second period. 1-0 lead for Calgary. Montreal on the man advantage. Chartrand was calling for that puck, but really nice play by Rebecca Johnston to break up that pass, and it causes Montreal to regroup.
That was definitely a great stick by Rebecca Johnson. And you know what's so frustrating about playing against the Calgary PK is that it's a little unorthodox. It's not something that you see for most teams. Team Canada, I know, uses it. And it's really frustrating as an offensive team because it's almost like they're rotating opposite of where that puck is. And they're constantly taking away the top two D up front and trying to prevent that cross-ice pass. So if you're trying to set up in an overload or an umbrella, they make it very difficult for you to be successful.
Calgary doing a good job here to kill some crucial seconds off Montreal's power play. 50 seconds left on that advantage for the visitors. Montreal will break out of their zone. Clement Hydra was able to pass that into the corner. Back to her. Centers. Bouncing puck. That's corralled into the corner once again. They'll play it back to the point. She's able to keep that in. That puck is played out in front. Good job by Mashmeyer to take care of her post, just putting her skate on it and preventing any sort of damage. Sorry, I'm chuckling because we're seeing some tempers flare here.
Well, it's, you know, the emotions are starting to run a little bit high there. What I loved about that save for Mashmeyer is that she had her skate right against that post, and the minute she had the opportunity to cover it, instead of staying there and allowing for them to whack away, she actually did a strong T-push away from the post so that she could remove herself from the chaos. And that's just a great play by the this goaltender.
And that puck deflected again, Mashmeyer. Good job just to deflect it into the corner, preventing any sort of dangerous rebound. And we are back to 5-on-5. Calgary dumps that puck in. Labonte, she will leave it. Played out in front for the Montreal captain, that's Poulin. Centers, chance here on the backhand. Mashmeyer handles it well, it's driven behind the net. That puck, centered, bouncing again, Mashmeyer, good save. She's made 14 of them tonight. And that puck is cleared out by Calgary, only to the neutral zone though. An opportunity here for Montreal. Slapper, that's deflected, now it's played behind the net. And Montreal, once again, into the Calgary zone. Nice save by Mashmeyer. Centered for Calgary. Gavrilova, she loses it. And Montreal on the far side. Slap shot, deflected. Montreal's picked up the pace here a little bit late in the second period. 2:22 left on the clock, 1-0 lead for Calgary. Shot on goal, Mashmeyer gets her glove on it, drives it behind her net. Two Montreal players behind the net. One of them tripped, although it looked like it was over her own skate.
Great pressure here by the Montreal or the Lake Canadians. They've done a really build momentum off of that power play. And that's what you want to see in a game like this when you're down by one. You want to keep that momentum moving in your direction.
Gosling intercepts that pass. Bram for Calgary. Played into the corner for Johnston. She looks behind her to see what options are available. Calgary still with the puck in the Montreal zone. They scoop that into the corner. Montreal back with possession. And Calgary pouncing on that at the blue line. They'll fight for it at the Calgary bench. Calgary coming away with it. Gosling for the Inferno. Centers. Goal! What a great job by Turnbull to redirect a great pass and make it a 2-0 game.
And you know what? That all came off of that battle at the blue line. They were persistent at the blue line to keep that puck in, and then they attacked the net. Blair Turnbull was there to put it in. Again, another one of those Calgary Inferno players that if you give her time and space, she's going to find the back of the net. Great job by Calgary on that. That's exactly what they want to do with a minute 19 before the second period ends.
So 2 second period goals here for Calgary to make it a 2-0 game over Montreal. Calgary putting on the pressure. There were some dicey minutes here, but Calgary really coming out to play. This game has been as advertised. So as Jenna had mentioned, we're late here in the second period, about 1:08 left on the clock. Calgary looking for another opportunity. That's Jess Campbell, plays it behind the net. Montreal coming down that right side. Bute centers it, deflected. Great save there by Mashmeyer. That puck looked like it was in a dangerous position. Perhaps it wasn't a shot, but she decided to deflect it and capture it to herself and basically calm things down.
She did a good job tracking that, but great push for Montreal, right? After you get scored on, all you want to make sure is that you come back and you put a little bit more pressure on, and that's what they did there. They had a good opportunity there to score. Nice job by them.
And a chance there just off the faceoff by Montreal, but Calgary was able to get it out of their zone, so prevent any late period damage, although we still have 33 seconds left on the clock. And fighting near the penalty box here for the puck, that's Saulnier for Calgary. She gets it to Irwin, who dumps it in, leaves it for Labonte. Chartrand will take it for Montreal. Calgary collecting an errant pass. Irwin with a chance. Labonte with a great save with her pad. And Montreal with a chance here very late. Looks like this period will expire. We've got a broken stick, I think, on the ice.
Yeah, that was a result of a Kathy Chartrand slap shot off the previous faceoff. Great period here. Shots are pretty even. Calgary with 19, Montreal with 18. It's a 2-0 game. I don't think Montreal is going to go into the dressing room disappointed with that. That was just solid hockey, two really good goals. It looks like Poulin's inquiring about something with the refs, perhaps unhappy about something, so we'll see if anything changes here going into the third. Overall, great pace. Again, that speed, you're starting to see the emotions start to run high. We're going to see a real battle going into the third period.
Yeah, it's getting chippy. As you said, emotions high on both sides. But a great game for anybody here that's in attendance and for anybody that's watching us online. Thanks for staying with us tonight. Much appreciated. Of course, thanks for tuning in all season to all of our broadcasts with Jenna and myself. So 40 minutes in the books. Calgary with 2 second period goals. The first coming courtesy of Irwin. That one came earlier in the period. Turnbull making it a 2-goal lead. Both goalies have looked pretty good. And we'll talk about that a little bit more, but why don't we head down to the dressing rooms and catch up with Kenzie.
Here with Britt Foracres from Montreal. Britt, down 2 goals going into the third. What's the team got to do the next 20 minutes?
Oh, we got to push. I mean, we're playing for first place here, and we know we got to bring the energy and the intensity and honestly take some risky chances and hope that we can put them in the back of the net and catch up and hopefully pass them.
Yeah, you guys have been neck and neck, tied for first place, going back and forth. Did you prepare any different this weekend than any other weekend?
No, I think we try week in and week out to prepare for the long shot, right? The Clarkson Cup. So every week's the same. We know that this is our matchup, and we, especially with this weekend coming in for first place, we definitely came in with a focus, but we definitely come in with the same attitude in all our games.
And being from Calgary, coming back to your hometown to play, how special is it, especially this huge crowd tonight, for you to play and probably some of your friends and family tonight?
Well, it's been a while. It's my sixth year out in Montreal, so I haven't been home to play many games, but it's amazing. And this crowd it makes the game. Honestly, the energy in here is awesome.
Okay, thanks, Brett. Good luck.
Thank you.
Breaking through, you're breaking through.
Kimmy, You do know that there's only 4 seasons, right?
Then how do you explain the way kids wish away the summer because we can't wait to play in the fall? Or how teammates often become best mates? Or how families have a vacation in Winnipeg in January because that's where the tournament is? So you see, Miss Woods, there is a 5th season, and it's the best season in Canada.
So you're talking about hockey?
Oh, it's more than just hockey, Miss Woods.
Scotiabank is proud to support over 5,000 teams in Canada's 5th season.
Not every group of girls has a friend in martial arts. Not every group of girls wants one. Not every girl spars with guys twice her size and age. Her friends say she has no life, but she does. Not every girl has a life as cool as mine.
I'm here with Jeff Stevenson, the GM for the Calgary Inferno. So I guess the most important thing, what are your thoughts on Start the Spark?
Well, I think it's fantastic what the players have rallied behind Jessica Campbell on to do with this cause. It's been 2 years of Start the Spark, 3 years is doing a game for youth mental health, seen it grow from that first game 3 years ago where we had a good crowd then to tonight where we've got 2/3 of this building, if not more, filled. It's great to see. It's great to see all the kids, but more importantly, it's great to see the work that's going on behind the scenes in the schools with the kids, the conversations that the players are going in and having, the training that the players are taking on themselves to go get so that they can be mentors, that they can help these kids through that tough time and maybe be that little bit of light in a very dark corner that someone might be in at the time. So I think that's what really makes this important is seeing that.
I think you're right. It's just another opportunity to showcase what the Inferno do in the community and how important the community is to the Inferno and being part of it. And like you said, the growth of Start the Spark in the last 3 years has been incredible. And I think each year more and more lives are touched by the Inferno as mentors. And it's just a benefit for a professional athlete to be able to go into a school and, you know, talk to these students and let them know that they are just like them, that there are a lot of things they can relate to, and I'm really impressed with the crowd here tonight for sure. Now, the hockey part of it.
Well, just one last thing, just like to add, sorry to cut you off there, but I mean, I think it really shows as well the character of these players on our team, and not just on our team, but on Montreal as well too. 2 years in a row they've played us in this game. 2 years in a row they've gone out, they've rocked the purple shirts for warm-up. This year they arranged and they got the ones with their own logo on it too, which is great, and it just shows that what type of players we have in this league, and it's fantastic to see.
Absolutely. I think it's across the league, and I think you're right. The support that each team shows each other, even though they're competitive on the ice at the end of the day, we're all here to support each other.
We're frenemies.
Yeah, something like that. Now, on the hockey side, what are the implications of this weekend?
Well, it's huge for us. I mean, it's a chance for us to do some things that we've never done as the Calgary Inferno before, and that's finish first in the league after the regular season. We've done it after the playoffs, but we haven't done it during the regular season, and we'd like to do that. It was one of the boxes that we've alluded to checking off, and it's the last one to check off for the regular season is clinch first. And right now there's still 20 minutes to play. We're in a good position, but we got to come out and play like we did for the first half of that game and a little bit at the end of the second period there and kind of leave that 10 minutes in between alone.
Perfect. You're right, I think Calgary's in a good position. There's still 20 minutes left. We know that Montreal is a good team, and there's always the opportunity for them to come back as well. Thank you for joining me today and talking a little bit about it.
Well, there's one other thing we want to talk about too, and that, of course, is the jersey auction from the game today as well too. Sorry to cut you off before
perfect.
I leave here, but of course, all the jerseys from the game that you see that were graciously donated by Scotiabank are available for auction at calgaryinferno.ca/auction. You don't need an eBay account to do that, but all 21 jerseys from the players that are here in the game, including Genevieve Lacasse, who didn't dress today, but it's a game issue jersey, is available there to bid on. Own a part of history there that was quite successful last year, raising $10,000 for the Sparks mentorship program. So hopefully we can do a little bit better this year and see if anyone beats the high jersey bid of last year, which was Rebecca Johnson at just over $1,100.
Which is amazing.
Yes, very.
And I agree. We've talked a lot about it tonight, just the importance of not only is it a jersey game worn by an Inferno player, but what that jersey fundraising goes towards. And again, it's going back to youth mental health, and it's such an important topic in our society. It's something that, you know, I know the players on our team, it's close to their hearts. And as a teacher, I see the importance in it every day that I go to work, to have people that come in that are part of the mentorship program and let kids know that at the end of the day, everybody struggles. And there's something and someone there to support you through it. So thank you, Jeff, for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
Enjoy the third period.
I shall.
Not every group of girls has a friend in martial arts. Not every group of girls wants one. Not every girl spars with guys twice her size and age. Her friends say she has no life, but she does. Not every girl has a life as cool as mine.
I was seven, I wore these gloves. They held this stick. Well, these skates carried me over the blue line.
We won the championship. And now, it's all yours.
Cool.
Oh,
and this mouth guard.
I'll get my own. Thanks.
The fifth season is when spirit for the game gets passed down. That's why we're proud to support over 5,000 teams.
Chevry's hockey journey started like any other young Canadian's. Born and raised in Nova Scotia, Corey was drawn to the game of hockey at an early age.
When I was about eight, I started to fall in love with the game. It was right around the time that the Mighty Ducks movies were coming out.
Corey would go on to develop her own passion for hockey, naturally and uninherited.
That's all I did. I played road hockey at 6 a.m., 6 p.m. on weekends. And then hockey every other time.
Corey's love of the game compelled her to pursue her passion through desire and sheer will.
I had asked my mom that if I could buy my own equipment, would she pay for my registration? And so I decided to have a yard sale, and I just kind of collected everything in the house that I could find. And I had a yard sale, bought my own gear, she paid for my registration, and then just continued to play ever since.
I first met Corey, tryouts in 2010, I believe. So it was about August 2010. I knew she was an East Coast girl who was thinking about playing on the West Coast, but decided to put her name in the CWHL draft, and knew that the Toronto Furies drafted her and was excited to try and be a part of the team.
After four seasons at St. Mary's University, Corey would go on to sign her first professional contract with the Toronto Furies.
Gets it over to Chevry, centering pass, and they score! Just like that, Chevry to Preville, and Toronto ties this one up.
In the six seasons Corey played for the Furies, she set three franchise records and won the 2014 Clarkson Cup. A moment she was able to share with her biggest supporter and number one fan.
Growing up, my mom was a single parent. She has two businesses, she's a full-time teacher. We've just always been taught to work hard and work for what we want.
She's probably one of the hardest workers I know. The girl goes from 7 in the morning until 9 at night. It's not hard to pick out in a crowd. We live in a 24-hour world, and Corey's running 25 hours a day.
Corey's work ethic, perseverance, and knowledge of the game landed her a spot at Ryerson Skate Training. 3 years later, an assistant coaching position opened up on the Ryerson Rams men's hockey team. And on August 12, 2016, Corey Chevry became the first female hired as a full-time assistant coach in CIS men's hockey history.
It's been amazing. You know, the players are smart. They see that she adds value in areas that they need help with. So as soon as they see that, they don't care, boy, girl, man, woman, you know, anything of that nature. They see she adds value, then they can help them, so they buy it.
I know what I bring to the table, and I know my work ethic, and I can go up against any guy who wants to be in the position that I'm in as well, and I think that I'm qualified for the job, and I'm going to continue to prove myself through my work ethic. Yeah, it's pretty surreal. I don't think it's quite hit me, and I don't know if I'll ever quite understand the magnitude that this brings, but I'm really fortunate that Ryerson has given the opportunity to me and believes in equal opportunity for men and women, regardless of the position.
For us, this is something big, right? But for a young girl, now she's going to grow up just knowing that, well, why wouldn't there be a woman behind the bench? There's no reason that she can't, and hopefully inspire one of these young ladies to do exactly what Corey's doing, because, hey, there may be a female Scotty Bowman out there somewhere, and could very well be Corey.
Hopefully sets a trend in the positive direction, and I think we're breaking barriers.
She's a pusher. She's the type of girl that is a pioneer. She's the one that's always pushing the envelope, and she's always the one saying, why not? I would love to see her hoist the Stanley Cup and be one of the first female coaches to do it. If not there, maybe a Memorial Cup, whatever. As far as I'm concerned, I'm proud of my friend, the fact that she's already behind the Ryerson bench and enjoying her time with the Rams.
Why can't I hold the Stanley Cup up next? That's kind of my mentality on everything. Why can't I do it?
And the third period just about to get underway here between Calgary and Montreal at Winsport Arena A. Mark and McPhail Center, what a game it's been thus far. Calgary with a 2-0 lead. Both of those goals coming in the second period, courtesy of Irwin and Turnbull. So what are you thinking here for the third period, Jenna? Obviously, Montreal, the passion was high. It was getting feisty. It was getting chippy. What are you thinking here for the final 20 minutes
of play? I think we're going to see a lot of that. I think we're going to see the emotions get a little bit higher here as the game progresses. We're going to see Montreal come out really trying to push that pace. They need to get more pucks to the net. Sometimes they make that extra pass, which is great when you can finish it. But in a game like this, they just need to get in Mashmeyer's face. So they need to drive that net, try to get her rattled a little bit so that they can maybe get one behind her early on.
Mashmeyer, the youngster, has looked very, very good tonight for the Inferno between the pipes. She's stopped 18 shots. On the other end, Labonte, she's been good for Montreal too. Two shots have beaten her, but she showed her veteran experience as well.
Labonte's had a fantastic game tonight. She's done really well. It's been a battle between her and Mash all night. Both goals that were scored tonight were good, great goals. So she can't be unhappy about that.
So we're early in the third period here between Calgary and Montreal. Montreal scooping that puck in. Calgary able to counter. They'll make their way through the neutral zone on that near side. And we'll get a face-off here.
Good pressure there by Montreal to start that period off. Calgary's going to want to respond, make sure that they get that puck in deep. Like it's always said, the two-goal lead in hockey is the worst one to have, and when Montreal's the team you're facing, I would have to agree that's true.
So Calgary with a face-off win. Johnston with some speed. She takes a shot on goal. Good save by Labonte. Montreal looking to clear that puck. Centers, chance here. Irwin looking to scoop it in. Bouncing in front. Puck goes to the corner. Gosling plays that in for Johnston. Johnston can't corral it, and Montreal will look to clear things out. Calgary with the puck. Saulnier. Saulnier with speed. Jenner's calling for it. She scoops it over to Jenner. Jenner curls around. She goes behind the net. Centers. Chance. Labonte sends it back behind the net. Good pressure here by Calgary to get going in this third period, trying to add to their 2-0 lead. Centers Pieri from the point, shot on goal, it's bouncing, goes behind the net. Puck out in front, Pieri able to keep it in. So she scoops it in, behind the net, on the half boards, back to the point. Nice job there by Montreal to stand up at the blue line and relieve some of that pressure the Calgary's been putting on here early to begin the final frame. Montreal dumps it in. Pate, nobody there for her though. Poulin was late on that change, so no harm, no foul from Calgary's perspective. Montreal on the near side. Deschain scoops it into the front. Nobody was there for a redirection. And now a chance for Calgary to counter. 2-on-1, 3-on-1 opportunity. Esposito calling for it. And a nice stick check there by the Montreal blue liner to prevent anything from happening on that chance. Deschain centers. Bate. Nice save by Mashmeyer.
Great rushes by both teams there in the last 30 seconds or so.
Really good job. Dostaller, she'll just dump it in. And Montreal will look to regroup.
It's good to see that pace of the game is still staying strong throughout the third period. Again, with those travel days in the CWHL, sometimes by that third, you can feel your legs. But in a game like this, with so much on the line, I think we're going to just see that pace continue to increase.
And we saw that right there. Great opportunity on that deflection for Calgary, but Labonte equal to the task to leave this at a 2-0 game, at least for now. 16:24 left on the clock. Calgary with that 2-goal lead.
That was a nice try by Campbell. I think everybody in the arena is wanting her to bury one tonight. Since this is her night, this is what she's put on. So nice try there by Campbell. Hopefully she'll squeeze one in here in the third.
Not that she doesn't always have a little pep in her step because she's a speedy player, but I can notice that she's really feeling it tonight. She must feel good to see so much purple in the crowd over something that she had so much to do with. So congrats to Jessica Campbell and everybody involved in Start the Spark. Chance there for Montreal. That scooped over to the side. Behind the net. Calgary trying to work their way out. Scramble in front of the Calgary bench. Bouncing. And that's Bram for the Inferno. CalgaryInferno.ca/auction if you're interested in the jerseys that these players are wearing. This all parts of Start the Spark, these special purple jerseys. You can own one. That puck sent in. Labonte will leave it. Montreal looking to work their way out. They're in front of the Montreal bench. Referees telling to get moving. And Montreal, that's Poulin to Bate. Poulin, Bate doing the give and go. Bate, shot on goal. That's deflected by Poulin. It gets caught up in her skates. They're in the corner now. Poulin, back to Bate. Shen will look for a line change, so Calgary with an opportunity to get things out here. On the near side, that's Jenner, forcing them to make a pass. Gets caught up at the blue line. Montreal. Down the far side, that shot in on Mashmeyer. Not a lot of action in front of her, but it seems to me she doesn't want to take any chances.
Yeah, you know, I think that was a good move by Mashmeyer to cover that puck up, kind of slow it down. The pace has been a little bit frantic here in the third period. Both teams are pushing, so I think this allows for everybody to kind of reset, regroup.
2-0 lead here for Calgary. We're in the third period. They've got a 2-goal lead over Montreal, 14:33 left here on the clock. Calgary down that far side, scooping out in front. Puck gets deflected into the corner. Calgary, good job to keep it in. Warren. Esposito, she loses that. And Montreal will curl around behind the net on the half board. Bounce pass out. And Montreal will dump that in. Icing call. So a chance for a breather. Now, just a reminder, the playoffs start next weekend. So a week from today will be game two. Game number one happening on Friday, February 24th. It's an 8 p.m. puck drop at Carstairs Memorial Arena. Game two goes Saturday, February 25th. It's a 3:30 puck drop. Back at Winsport, however, we're in a different arena. It's Joan Snyder Arena, and what you need to keep in mind between this one is that only 220 tickets are available. So that's, of course, game two. It could be a crucial one. It could be the one that seals the deal for Calgary or their opponent. So you want to be there. We will be broadcasting that game, so keep that in mind. And then game three, of course, if needed, goes Sunday, February 26th, 12:45. They'll head back to Carstairs Memorial Arena if necessary.
That took a weird bounce. Labonte's looking like she's a little bit slow to get up here.
It looks like she's favoring one of her hands.
Yeah, they were jamming away there at the side of the net. So looks like she's going to be able to shake it off and continue. So that's good to see.
And she has been busy tonight. She's faced 23 shots, two of them able to get past her. And Montreal with a faceoff win with 13:46 left. They're looking to put their first goal past Mashmeyer down the half board. Montreal. Chance here. Rougeau, slapper. Great save by Mashmeyer. Kudos to her there, because there was tons and tons of traffic, and she was able to look through the bodies and put her glove on it.
Fantastic save by Mash. Once again, just coming out to the tops of her crease to really challenge the shooter. As a shooter and someone who was a forward, still is, I guess, that's the most frustrating part when a goalie comes out to challenge, because they give you nothing to shoot at. And when teams are this good, you don't have the chance to make that move often. So great job by Mashmeyer to really challenge it.
13:25 here left on the clock. We're in the third period. Calgary with a 2-0 lead over Montreal. Johnston trying to clear that out. Calgary does so. Johnston up ice with Bram. Bram leaves it for Johnston. Johnston can't get a stick on it. Back into the corner. Ooh. And unfortunately, our vantage point not the best here, but someone went into the boards pretty hard face first. Looks like she's okay. I think that was Cudmore. Tough to tell. And a chance here for Montreal extinguished. Pierre, she'll regroup in the neutral zone. That's Jenner. Pierre takes a fall, but she's able to get back on her feet and get the puck out.
Yeah, a bit of a caught an edge there.
Yeah, right in front of the bench.
You can see Montreal starting to use their body a little bit more, and that's really the only way you can slow this Calgary team down, is to get in front of them, and that's what they're starting to do a little bit more here in the third period.
Yeah, I've noticed Calgary really running with those lines right now. Everybody getting a little bit of playing time. We're in the Calgary corner. Now we're behind the net. Laquette looking for some options. Gosling comes over to help her out. Gavrilova, that pass intercepted. Chance here for Montreal. Lafour centers. Mashmeyer on the post. Good job by her players, fellow players, to help her out. Rowe. Throw for Montreal, back to the point. Lafour, she loses it. And Warren for Calgary will work her way out to Esposito. Back to Warren.
Great behind try there.
Yeah, behind the Montreal net. Just everybody's fighting for that puck. Every inch of ice, very crucial right now in this 2-0 game. Montreal looking to put their first one past Mashmeyer tonight. Calgary centering. Nobody there. A bit of a bounce. Esposito doesn't miss by much on that right-hand top corner.
Definitely a right idea from on hers. You want to go upstairs. Labonte was down, but she just went a little bit high.
And Montreal with an opportunity to clear out of their zone. That's Clement Hydra on her own. She'll dump it in. Mash Meyer. She's faced 21 shots tonight. Bouncing puck. And Calgary corrals it in. Behind the Montreal zone. Rather net. Swings it around. Back behind the net for Calgary. Turnbull. She made it a 2-0 game. She'll play it to Pieri. But a chance now for Montreal. 2-on-1 opportunity. And that puck getting away a little bit from Ohl. And Calgary will need to work fast and get organized in their own zone, because that's Poulin coming in for Montreal. She's always aggressive with her speed on that forecheck.
Yeah, she's going to be pushing here, trying to lead her team.
Getting chippy there. Looks like we will have a penalty. We'll see who it's going for.
Yeah, I'm not sure Montreal's going to be happy with this one. That kind of looked like just one of those plays where it's a little chaotic and three players kind of ended up hitting each other, but it looks like Montreal is going to come away with a penalty on this one.
I'm a little surprised with this one too. Actually, is it Calgary? Okay.
Actually, Calgary's going to the box on this one. That's interesting. Jackie Pieri actually had the puck in the corner and is somehow going to be the one in the box.
So a crucial power play here for Montreal if they want to get back in this one. They're trailing 2-0 on the scoreboard.
Whoa. This looks interesting. Oh. I'm wondering if she's actually going to be ejected. She's going to the bench and she's leaving the game. I am absolutely stunned by this call, and I will be interested to hear what the penalty is on this one.
Yeah, just for anybody who's following us on the web stream, the angle that Jenna and I have is the corners are very, very blind for us, so we couldn't exactly see what happened there, but it looks like Pieri has left the game. Montreal will have an opportunity on the power play. They do have the first ranked power play in the CWHL, and a crucial opportunity here for them. 9:24 left on the clock. Calgary with a 2-0 lead. Okay.
It almost looks like they were signaling as if she had kicked or used her skate on the Montreal player. Just looking at the replay here real quick to see what that looks like. I mean, they were quite tangled in the corner on that one.
Anything, it looks like it may have been inadvertent, but nonetheless,
Montreal on the power play.
So an opportunity here for Montreal to get one, perhaps two back on Calgary. Again, 2-0 lead for the Inferno, 9:11 left on the clock, and Montreal on the man advantage. Shot there, Mashmeyer directs it into the corner, behind the net, two Montreal players. Calgary rims it around, and they're able to get it out. So a good start to the kill here for the Inferno. Poulin looking for some support. Rougeau back to Poulin. The Montreal captain centers it. It's bouncing in front of the Calgary goal. That's Mikkelsen for the Inferno. Back to the point for Montreal. Bouncing pass. Gets in on Mashmeyer. She was able to deflect it, and Calgary with a chance to clear it. They can. So they'll get a line change here, and Montreal will regroup as Labonte decides to leave it.
This is a big opportunity for Montreal. They have a 7-minute penalty. There's a power play, and there's only 8 minutes left in the game. This is going to be a huge test for Calgary here for the next little bit.
So Calgary on the kill. They did a good job there. 5:32 left on the man advantage for Montreal. So in this kind of an opportunity, if you're a Montreal player, do you take your time and try and set something up?
You always,
because you have that time?
You know, on the power play, you always want to have some urgency. Sometimes it's easy to become complacent, and that's when teams get odd man breaks. So, yes to urgency, but you don't want to force anything because you know you have 7 minutes, or as Montreal has, five left. So it's a little bit of both. You want to make sure that you're still puck battling and getting to the puck, but at the same time, not forcing anything unnecessary.
And good job here by Warren and Turnbull, preventing Montreal from doing anything too dangerous. They're quite chippy on that blue line, and Montreal will have to regroup once again. So that's Chartrand with the puck right now for Montreal. She'll survey, see what opportunities arise.
So it does look like that penalty to Pierre was for kicking, and that's not one that I think I've ever heard in all my years of playing. So I'm curious what the actual penalty call is, but that's an unfortunate one, and as someone that has played with her for a long time, I know she's not going to be happy with that one. And yeah, that's just unfortunate.
Calgary's doing a good job here, though, to kill some time, and looks like Irwin's been hurt.
Yeah, something's going on there. She's really struggling to get off the ice, and it looks like it's a lower body injury, not putting a lot of weight on that right foot.
So a bit of unfortunate circumstances here for Calgary. 6 minutes and a little bit of change here left in the third period. Calgary with that 2-0 lead. Montreal with the power play. Here they center it. Not getting a lot of wood on that one. Coming out in front, Mashmeyer. She gets down low, able to keep it out. Amard keeps it in at the blue line for Montreal. Here she comes in, takes a deflection off Jenner's skate. Luckily for Calgary, the captain looks to clear it and just gets by. So Calgary will have a chance to get some new bodies out on the ice, and they'll clear it once again. Johnston calling for it for Calgary. Johnston still with the puck, shot on goal, just goes wide.
Nice try there. You know, you just see that patience from Johnston. That puck was bobbling, and she was able to just slow it down and create something.
Here's Poulin. Look at her go. She drives behind the net, looks for the centering pass. Still with the puck, Poulin. Poulin back to the point. Back to Poulin. Centers. Great save by Mashmeyer. And Rougeau will try to regroup for Montreal. She fights off Davis. Now Chartrand. Back to Chartrand on the point. Duchenne behind. Circles around. Montreal looking for a give and go play there. Centers. Bodies everywhere. Everybody's flying about. Calgary with a chance to clear it. Davis, a diving opportunity. She can't, and Montreal still with 2 minutes and 8 seconds left here on the power play. Great block. That puck trickles through.
Wow, what an opportunity there for Montreal on the back door. It was just not able to put that puck in. They had a great chance to do so, but wasn't able to sneak it in. Calgary's done an incredible job. Montreal's constantly trying to force that puck to go middle. You can see how they're setting up. They want to keep it to the outside, couple quick passes, and they're looking for that player in the high slot. Calgary's doing a good job of trying to keep them to the outside. Mashmeyer's doing a good job of not giving up any rebounds. And when Calgary has the opportunity like that right there, Cudmore gets it deep. And that's exactly what they want to be doing during this.
So 3 minutes, 50 seconds left here in the game. Montreal still on the power play. Calgary, though, with a 2-0 lead. Montreal centered it, looking for a deflection out in front, but Calgary comes away with the puck. That's Turnbull. And Montreal has indeed pulled their goalie, so 3:30 left, giving them six on four. My math, not so good. And in a night where we've seen everything when it comes to this game.
You know what? This is going to be interesting because they're going to call too many men on Montreal, but their goaltender's pulled, so.
Yeah, Poulin arguing with the referee right now, and rightfully so. I'm not really sure what's happening. I've never seen anything like this. This is completely bizarre.
And their goaltender's been pulled for quite some time, so I'm surprised that this is this is going to be a penalty. I'm just waiting to see here on the replay to see if there's actually extra people on the ice for Montreal.
So we've got Poulin and Chartrand. They're discussing with the referee right now, both clearly frustrated, shaking their heads, and they're not going to win this battle. And Montreal's coach, incensed right now.
Well, he's wanting the referee to come talk to him, and the referee just has no interest in doing so. So this will be interesting to see. I'm still waiting to just kind of see if I can catch it here on the replay.
Labonte headed back to the goal here. So we will have 4-on-4 for about 59 seconds. And then Calgary will go to the power play. So an interesting turn of events right now. 4-on-4. And Mashmeyer decides she'll hang on. 3:16 left in the game. Calgary with that 2-0 lead. Interesting turn of events here, I gotta say. In all my years of watching hockey, I can't say I've ever really seen anything like this happen.
Well, I'm also surprised by it, and it really does change it. And, you know, in a game of this importance, you never want to see something where it goes down to special teams. So this has been an interesting third period.
And you don't want to see a potential reffing call really make that much of a difference in a game like this of this magnitude, like you said. But let's continue on. Under 3 minutes left here in the third period. That's Bate with the puck. Chartrand, she loses it. Again, we're 4-on-4. Bate keeps it in at the blue line. Poulin back to Chartrand. They'll cycle a little bit. Shot on goal. Good save by Mashmeyer. And a chance here for Jenner. She'll go down on that far side. She's looking for a pass at the point. Mickelson, she had enough speed, so she'll come in on the near side of your screen, take it behind the net, centered. Nobody was there, unfortunately, and Johnston will have to go back into her own zone and get some support to take it out. She leaves it for Mickelson. Mickelson taking her time. Calgary now on the power play for 46 seconds. They have a 2-0 lead. Just about 2 minutes left here in the third period. And Montreal with an opportunity to clear things out, which they do. Clement Hydra. And now it's Mickelson for Calgary. Montreal with the possession of the puck. Alberta product, 4 acres with it now.
Wow, it's hard to believe that Calgary actually has ended up on the power play to finish this game after the seven minutes worth of penalties that they were given not that long ago.
Yeah, an interesting third period here. No goals, but a lot to talk about and a lot to dissect in terms of who was headed to the penalty box and why. Montreal now with an opportunity. Late, 1:22 left on the clock. Again, the goalie has been pulled. And Calgary looking to get it out, which they do. Chance here, open net for Calgary, Saulnier, but she'll just play it into the corner. Clement Hydra for Montreal. She'll play it wide to Rougeau. She's on your near side, puts it in. Calgary tried to stop it at the blue line. Last minute of play here in the third period between Calgary and Montreal. The Inferno with a 2-0 lead. Two crucial points on the line. First place on the line in the CWHL in the second last game of the regular season. And Calgary able to clear it. Opportunity here on the open goal. And Saulnier scores! 3-0 for Calgary.
And you can just hear the crowd that's still here tonight watching this game. Stoked about that goal, even though it puts Calgary up 3-0. You can still hear the support here at Winsport.
Tough for Montreal.
So tough. They go from a 7-minute power play. And, you know, I've been looking at the replay here, and Labonte looks like she's in the bench and has been for a while. So they're going to look back at that and not be too pleased about that call.
So 30 seconds left here between Calgary and Montreal. Calgary with a 3-0 lead. And this has been an exceptional, exceptional game. It's what we came out here to see. It's what we teed up earlier before Puckett dropped in the first period. We expected an awesome game. So much talent here. So many gold medals in between these two teams. We got Poulin, Boutte, of course, on Montreal. An experienced goaltender on one end. A youngster on the other end. A full circle situation between the pipes in terms of Team Canada on Hockey Day in Canada. Really does not get any better than this.
You couldn't
to be
have
honest.
Asked for a better game. Yeah. I mean, and this is what we've been anticipating all year. I know when we've called the other games, we were looking forward to this one. We knew it was going to be a battle. We knew it was going to be a good game. Shots are almost dead even.
So Calgary, 3-0 win over Montreal in the Start the Spark game. Very special night here at Winsport Arena A. They celebrate with Emerence Mashmeyer, who made 25 saves to earn the shutout. She was exceptional, I have to say. She was tracking that puck like a veteran.
You know, she did exactly what they needed her to do tonight. She played strong. She made some really big saves. And that's what they need when they're playing a team like Montreal. Great game from both sides. A 3-0 score. I mean, I think the game was even closer than that,
yeah.
Even though 3-0 is pretty close. Montreal's going to go back and not be impressed, I think, with that last call. Like I said, I've looked at the replay a couple of times, and Labonte seemed to have been in the bench or on the bench well before that play, which is unfortunate because this was a great game, and it turned out to be perhaps not quite as close at the end because Calgary once again was on that power play.
You certainly don't want this decided by, I realize Calgary was up 2-0 at that point, but if you're Montreal and you have a 7-minute power play opportunity and that gets negated by a call like that, that's really frustrating.
It's hard to take, and I think, you know, Montreal is going to have to go back into the locker room tonight and make sure that when they wake up tomorrow, they leave this one in the past because they should be proud of how they played. They did a great job. Playing with Calgary. Calgary did a great job playing with Montreal. Both goaltenders were phenomenal tonight. They did exactly what their teams needed. The goals that were scored against Labonte were good goals.
Yes, they were.
One was an open net, so she can be quite happy with how she played today. And, you know, it's great Calgary could win in front of this crowd and put on a great show. Overall, great night to watch hockey.
Yeah.
Great night for the CWHL. And just another reason why this league is so important and something that people should be invested in, because the hockey's only getting better. The fans are growing.
That's right.
The players, you know, and the community support is continuing to grow. So overall, fantastic evening.
So a couple of things to take away from this win for Calgary. Again, they do play Montreal tomorrow. It's a 12:15 puck drop. Same arena here, Winsport Arena A. However, with Calgary's win tonight, they get two crucial points. And as a result, Calgary will indeed clinch first place. We have confirmed this with Inferno GM Jeff Stevenson. I know you had him on in the second intermission. So Calgary will finish first in the CWHL this year, which is a fantastic achievement. And also with this win, they do remain perfect at home. They have yet to lose here. So truly is home ice advantage here at Winsport and the Mark and McPhail Center, which has just been a fantastic place to watch hockey all season. We had so many people here tonight. Best crowd of the season. And we've had a couple of good ones, I will say. And this has been a fantastic one. So a lot of things
absolutely
to take away, right?
And you know, it's nice to see Irwin's back on the ice coming out for that second star award. The first star does go to Mashmeyer, well-deserved. To shut out Montreal, I think, is phenomenal on any given night. So for sure, deserving of that first star.
Not to get like sentimental, but I think it's really interesting that you have Charlene Labonte, who's done so much for hockey in Canada at one end, and she has this storied career. And then you have Mashmeyer, who's just getting her feet wet in the program.
Yeah, I think it just goes to show that the goaltending has progressed and continues to progress. And, you know, that Labonte's around to kind of help Mashmeyer navigate what it's like to be a member of the national team and what it's like to compete in the CWHL. And you see them just chatting.
Yeah.
Goes to show they've been here competing against each other. They're still friends. They've got something to learn from each other. It's great to see.
Yeah, Mashmeyer, just a talent. Everybody keep your eye on her. Of course, Sochi, I'm sorry. Sochi was 3 years ago, but next year, we will be in Pyeongchang, South Korea. So for the next Olympics, I don't know where the past 3 years have gone, to be honest with you. But that is a player to look out for. Mashmeyer has a very, very brilliant future ahead of her. And how lucky are we in Calgary to be able to watch her progress right now? And it's been an exceptional season for her. And we're going to be hearing from her, I believe, as well as Labonte, in a moment. We'll head down to the dressing rooms. Kenzie's been very busy tonight. And why don't we head down to Kenzie and we'll hear from one of the stars from Montreal.
So we came here knowing that, you know, being finishing first was on the line. So it was two big, big games. And we've had great battles along the year against Calgary. And it was a good game. And, I it was a special game too with Do It For Daryl. And it was it's fun that the crowd showed up. And it was a great game. I mean, it's never fun to be on the losing side. But I think it showcased women's hockey and how great it is. So I think that's what we want.
And looking forward to tomorrow's game. What are your guys' plans to come back with or go back to Montreal with a win tomorrow?
I mean, it's the last game of the season. We're missing a couple players, so it's hard. But, you know, our team just played their hearts out. And then we kind of came in being maybe a bit of the underdogs. But it's our last game before the playoffs. And we're just going to get some rest. And I'm expecting another great game tomorrow.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you.
So just hearing from Charlene Labonte of Montreal, she had a great game. She faced 24 shots, not a lot she could do. Obviously, the third goal was an empty netter, but she was very, very good. And you can see why she's been around in the world of hockey for so long when she's so steady, and obviously her team feeds off of her.
Yeah, I mean, she's one of the leaders on the team for sure, and I think she just played a solid game. And even her response to the game today, knowing they played well,
yeah.
First place was on the line, but at the end of the day, the Clarkson Cup's the ultimate goal.
That's right. So why don't we head back to the dressing room, and we will head down there and hear from the first star tonight, Emerence Mashmeyer.
Hey, Emerence, big win tonight. Start the Spark was a huge success. Tell me about the game.
I mean, I can't complain about the game. Shutting out Montreal is a pretty unbelievable feeling, especially after the past couple weekends that we played against them. We were 500, so obviously this is a huge game to clinch first, too, and I'm proud of my team for how they played.
And looking forward, knowing that your first place, is the pressure on? Do you practice differently? Is the mindset different, or is it all the same to you guys?
Yeah, I think the best thing to do is be consistent, and I think, you know, we've been working hard all year, so why change what we were doing? It's working, and of course there's more pressure, you know, being at the top, everyone wants to beat you, but pressure is good, so.
And going into next weekend, looking at playoffs, you guys actually aren't in a regular home arena. How's that going to change kind of the energy in dressing room and stuff like that?
I mean, it's still home ice, even though we're in Carstairs or, you know, out there. But, no, we're excited to be here and not be flying, you know, across the country. You know, that's always an advantage for sure.
Okay, thanks, Em.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kenzie. And just hearing from Emerence Mashmeyer, she made 25 saves. Shutout tonight, she looked exceptional. Not really a rookie in my books.
No, definitely not. I mean, she's done, her whole career's been amazing, and I think they're going to look for that next weekend. I would be surprised if she's not the number one going into playoffs. Yeah. So we'll see more of her this year. And overall, I just thought this was a great game, and tomorrow's going to be a great game too.
And she talked about it. How great must it feel to beat Montreal, a team with the likes of Poulin and Bette, and to stop them?
Yeah, absolutely.
Now, we did mention playoffs. You heard Emerence mention it, but we'll mention it as well. So the playoffs begin for Calgary next week, Friday. The game is at 8 o'clock at Carstairs Memorial Arena. That's just a little bit outside of the city. So still home ice advantage, but not like it is, I guess, here. But regardless, we're still in the Calgary area. And then Saturday, we head back here to Winsport, but we'll be in Jones-Snyder Arena. So that's just next to us here. And keep it in mind, because only 220 tickets are available. So you want to scoop those up fast. And that arena is really interesting. It's almost like you're sitting on top of the ice. So a bit of a different vantage point if you're interested in that. And then the third game, if needed, would be on Sunday, and that would head back to Carstairs. So if you're interested in tickets, you can head over to calgaryinferno.ca. Speaking of calgaryinferno.ca, you can also, you notice that, of course, the players were wearing their purple jerseys. That's part of Start the Spark. And you can, those jerseys, you can buy them. They're a part of an auction. So calgaryinferno.ca/auction, and you can purchase those or you can at least bid on them and hopefully purchase one of them. But last season, they were actually able to get $10,000 raised. So I think we're going to call it a night. That's our final regular season game, at least for Jenna and myself. You should see us next week, barring anything else, I guess. And a big thank you to everybody who joined us today. We had a lot of special guests, including Sheldon Kennedy, Rob Cote of the Calgary Stampeders, as well as GM Jeff Stevenson. And for you for sticking around with us tonight, thank you so much for tuning in, and we will see you soon.
Kimmy, you do know that there's only four seasons, right?
Then how do you explain the way kids wish away the summer because we can't wait to play in the fall? Or how teammates often become best mates? Or how families happily vacation in Winnipeg in January because that's where the tournament is? So you see, Miss Woods, there is a fifth season, and it's the best season in Canada.
So you're talking about hockey?
Oh, it's more than just hockey, Miss Woods.
Scotiabank is proud to support over 5,000 teams in Canada's fifth season.
Not every group of girls has a friend in martial arts. Not every group of girls wants one. Not every girl spars with guys twice her size and age. Her friends say she has no life, but she does. Not every girl has a life as cool as mine.